Hello dear students, welcome to the problem solving session on eccentrically loaded welded connections. In this video I will try to solve some problems related to eccentrically loaded welded connection. I have made some videos on the design of eccentrically loaded welded connections. In case you haven't watched it, you will find a link at the top right corner. Click on it and watch it. So let's start with some easy problem and then eventually we will try to solve some harder problems. Okay, so this is your problem, which says that a welded connection as shown in figure below is subjected to an eccentric force of 7.5 kN. The load applied is 7.5 kN. Determine the size of the weld if the permissible shear stress for the weld is 100 Newton per mm square or 100 megapascal. Assume static conditions. So we have to find out the size of the weld. We have to find out the size of the weld in this question. And it is given that a load of 7.5 kN at some eccentricity E is applied. Now first of all we will try to find out the center of gravity. Center of gravity or centroid, because the both points will be same in this case. Now as you can see that for that what I will do, the first step will be to fix my Cartesian coordinate system, and I'll fix it at the bottom left corner. This will be my x-axis and this will be my y-axis. So all the distances which I'll measure from now on will be with respect to this origin O. The second thing is that you can see that the weld is basically symmetric about x and y axis. Obviously there are no welds about x axis, or rather there are no welds along parallel along y axis. They are only along the x axis. So since the welds are symmetric about both the axes, that's why we can say that the center of gravity or the centroid will lie at this center, 25 mm from this side, that 25 mm, that means this distance will be 25, and similarly this distance again will be 25. So if I measure my coordinate systems from the origin of this Cartesian coordinate system, its coordinate will be 25, 25, okay, which makes my eccentricity equal to 25 plus 100, that will be 125 mm. Mind it, all the dimensions which are given on this figure are in mm. Now the next thing is, as I have already told you in the previous lecture, that while solving these types of problems, what you do, first of all you bring this force at the center of gravity. This force of same magnitude, you will bring it at the center of gravity. So we will try to bring this force at the center of gravity. Its magnitude again is 7.5 kN, and since we have brought this force from this place to this place, there will be a clockwise moment which we will denote by m, and whose magnitude is equal to p times e. So in such types of problem, first of all we will try to draw the free body diagram and clearly mentions the different, we will clearly mention the different types of distances which we are going to use in the problem. So let's draw the first weld. This is your weld 1, this is your weld 2. At the center you are having your center of gravity, whose coordinate system is, whose coordinates are 25, 25 with respect to a coordinate system which is kept at the bottom left corner. Your eccentricity was equal to 125 mm, and the moment which was induced at the about the center of gravity is P cross E. Now obviously the primary shear stresses will be in this direction, and the load which is applied is in the is towards is in the downward direction. The next thing is we have to the farthest point with respect to G are point number 1, this is point number 2, point number 3 and point number 4. These four points are equidistant from center of gravity and they are at the farthest point on the weld. So you can find out any of the basically you can find out the distance of any of the point from the center of gravity. So let's say I'm going to find out this distance and I'll call this distance as R. Okay, now this distance from here to here is 25 and vertically it is also 25, because if you remember the coordinate of the center of gravity is 25, 25 and this complete distance is 50, which will make this distance as 25, and again this complete distance is 50, which will make this distance as 25. Mind it, the length of the weld is also 50. Now R can be easily calculated with using the Pythagoras theorem. Your R will be equal to under root 25 square plus 25 square, which will be equal to, let's find out what is R, 25 square plus 25 square, it is 35.35 or 36. If we will round it off, it will be 35.36 mm. So this is your R. What is R? R is the distance of a point on the weld which is farthest from the center of gravity. Next thing we are going to we will try to find out the primary shear stress. The magnitude of the primary shear stress is P upon A. P is the load acting on the structure, that is 7500. Area of the weld is equal to T times the length of the weld, and since there are two identical welds, that's why we are going to multiply it with 2. Multiplied by T multiplied by L. This will be equal to 7500 divided by the length of the weld is, okay, it's not 100, it's, let's rub this out, the length of the weld is 50. So this will make 100 times T, because we still don't know what is T. That's what we have to find it out in this question. So your primary shear stress is equal to 75 divided by T Newton per mm square. This is your primary shear stress. Now the next thing is to find out the secondary shear stress. The secondary shear stress is equal to M times R divided by J. You already know what is R, that is 35.36 mm. From here you can find out what is M, that is your M is equal to P times E. Your P is 75 kilonewtons, that means 75,000. Multiplied by 125, because eccentricity is 125. This will give you 7500 multiplied by 175 is 9,37,500. 9,37,500 Newton millimeter. Okay, it is Newton millimeter. Next, or the last thing which we need to find out is the polar moment of inertia. So what we will do, first of all, G1 is the center of gravity of the first weld, G2 is the center of gravity of the second weld.
So the length of the welds are equal and they are equidistant from the center of gravity. That's why what we will do, we will find out the polar moment of inertia of one weld by center of gravity, and then we are going to multiply it with 2, because both the welds are identical and they are equidistant from the center of gravity. So in order to find out the polar moment of inertia of first weld about u. First of all, we will find out the polar moment of inertia by this own center of gravity. So the formula for the polar moment of inertia by this own center of gravity, J u1 represents the polar moment of inertia of any weld about its own center of gravity. Since I have written g1, that means about we are talking about first weld. This is equal to I x plus I y. Yeah, I x is equal to L T cube upon 12, where L is the length of the weld and T is the thickness of the weld, plus T L cube upon 12. Now, as we have discussed earlier, that T is a very small quantity and the cube is even smaller. That's why what we will do, we are going to neglect this quantity. We are going to neglect this quantity for the ease of calculation. So J G1 is going to be equal to T L cube upon 12. T L cube upon 12. Now this value which we got here is basically the polar moment of inertia about this G. But G1. But we are interested in finding out the polar moment of inertia about G. So for that, what we are going to do, we are going to use the parallel axis theorem. And this distance from G1 to G, distance from G1 to G, we are going to denote this distance as R1. And this distance R1 is 25 for this particular case. So if we are going to use the parallel axis theorem, we will get J1G. J1G is, or I'll write it as J1. J1 is the polar moment of inertia of the first weld about G. This will be equal to TL cube upon 12 plus the area of the weld multiplied by the distance R1 squared. So yeah, J will be equal to T L cube upon 12 plus TL, TL is the area of the weld, multiplied by R1 square, that is 25 square. Let's take T outside because we don't know what is the value of T, and that's what we have to find out. This is J1. And this will be your L cube by 12 plus 25 square into L. Let's put the values of the unknown. Let's put the value of the known in this equation. Your L is equal to 50, so this becomes 50 cube divided by 12 plus 25 square multiplied by 50. Let's find out what this is equal to. 50 square divided by 12 plus 25 square divided multiplied by 50. Okay, 50 cube, it's not 50 square, it's 50 cube. So this will be equal to 41666.67 mm raised to the power 4. So this is the polar moment of inertia of the first weld about G. Let's find out the total polar moment of inertia of all the welds about G. This will be equal to J1 plus J2, and since J1 and J2 are equal, that's why we can use 2 multiplied by J1. This will give me a value equal to 8333.34 mm to the power 6. Now we have all the values in order to find out what is our secondary shear stress, that is tau 2. Tau 2 is equal to M into R upon J. So J is equal to 8 in 4 times 3 dot 3 4. Almost you are 75,000 because it's kilonewton multiplied by your E, that is 125 N, multiplied by R, that was I don't remember the value, it's 35.36. So this will give you your secondary shear stress, which is 75,000 multiplied by 125 multiplied by 35.36 and divided by 8.34. Okay, this is not 75,000, rather it is 7500 because it's 7.5 kilonewtons. So that's why I was not getting the right answer. It, now the correct answer is 397.8 newton per mm square. And our tau 1 was the primary shear stress was 75 upon 3 newton per mm square. Again, this will be divided by 2. Because this K, I will totally forget that it is multiplied by 2. Okay? So that's why your secondary shear stress will be 297.8 divided by 2. Okay, now let's show these shear stresses on our free body diagram. The direction of the primary shear stress is this, tau 1, and the direction of the secondary shear stress is tau 2. Or if I want to show over here, it will be like this. This is tau 2 and this is my tau 1. Now since this distance is equal to this distance, is equal to this distance, that means this angle is 45 degrees, which makes this angle again as 45 degrees. So the angle between both the shear stresses is 45 degrees. Now it becomes very easy for us to vectorially answer. This is tau 1, which is 75 by 2 newton per mm square. So it will be the value of the shear stress is given to you in the question as 100 megapascals.
The value of the permissible shear stress is given to you in the question as 100 megapascal. So tau, which is your permissible shear stress, is given to you in the question as 100 megapascal, and it is also equal to the vector tau 1 plus tau 2. Okay, this should be, basically this is the shear stress which is induced inside the weld. Because of the load P acting at the eccentricity E, and this is the maximum allowable shear stress of the weld. So both of these quantities, if we equate both these quantities, we will get the value of the T, which is the size of the weld. So 100 newton per mm square or megapascal is equal to the summation of tau 1, tau 2 done vectorially. So which is equal to tau 1 square plus tau 2 square plus 2 tau 1 tau 2 cos theta, and all of these quantities are under root. Now let's put the values of all these things. Your tau 1 is from here you can see that your tau 1 is 75 upon t and your tau 2 is 397.8 upon t. So 75 upon t whole square. Whole square plus 397.8 upon t whole square plus 2 into 75 upon t into 397.8 upon t into cos theta, where theta is the angle between tau 1 and tau 2, and for this particular case it is 45 degrees. It is 45 degrees, all in the under root. So if you solve this equation, you will get, or if you solve this value under inside the under root, this will give you 100 is equal to 454 upon t, and your t will be equal to 4.54 mm. 4.54 mm is the correct answer for this question. Now, while solving these problems, always keep in mind that you have to be very careful with the units. You have to put all the quantities in the proper units in order to get the correct answer. And whenever the size of the weld is asked to you, you have to basically find the throat size. So this is how you are going to solve this problem. Now let's see another problem. This question says that an eccentrically loaded bracket is welded to the support as shown in figure below. The permissible shear stress for the weld material is 55 MPa and the load is static. Determine the throat and the leg dimensions for the weld. So first of all, you can see that this time we are having three welds. This is your weld number 1, this is your weld number 2, and this is your weld number 3. Now the next important thing is that the weld is symmetric about a vertical axis. About this axis your weld is symmetric. That's why the x coordinate of the centroid will lie at the center of this line, or will lie at this particular line. So your center of gravity will lie somewhat at this point, whose coordinate will be 50 comma yc. Now we have to find out this yc, but this is 50 because your welds are symmetric about your vertical axis, and since you have a weld at the top but you don't have any weld at the bottom, that's why the center of gravity of the centroid is shifted little bit towards the weld number 3. Now the next thing is, again a load of 25 kN is applied at this point with the eccentricity equal to 150. That's because this distance from here to here is 50 plus 100 mm from this point to this point, which makes total of 150 mm. So your eccentricity is 150 mm, and your load is of magnitude 25 kN, which is acting at this point. So for such type of problem, what we do, we bring this load at the line of action of the load should pass through the center of gravity like this, and there will be a moment induced because we have shifted this load from this point to this point. So there will be a moment which will be induced at the about the center of gravity. Now you already know what are the effects of this load and the moment, so I will not repeat that. But the magnitude of the moment will be equal to P cross E, and as done in the previous problem, we will first of all try to draw the free body diagram indicating all the distances and the forces acting on the weld. So in this figure over here, you can see that again the load is 25 kN, which has been shifted to this point. which will be shifted to this point, and there will be a moment about this point. Next thing is, as I told you, this is your weld 1, weld 3 and weld 2. G1, G2 and G3 are the center of gravity of the respective welds. G1 is the center of gravity of the first weld and so on. Y bar is the basically the you have to find out the coordinates of this point G. So Y bar is the y coordinate of the center of gravity, and you already know what is the x coordinate, that is 50 comma y bar. Now I'll fix my reference, or the basically I'll fix the Cartesian coordinate system at this point. This is your x axis and this is your y axis, and this point over here is your origin. So as I told you in the previous lecture, that for calculating the centroid, you will treat the welds as a line because the thickness of all the welds are same. So y bar is equal to summation of li's, sorry, it will be yi's li's and yi's divided by summation of li's. So if you talk about weld 1, the length of weld 1 is given to you as 150 mm multiplied by yi. Yi is the distance of the center of gravity of the first weld from the origin. Okay, it is the distance from the center of gravity of the first weld from the origin on y axis. So it is, this total length is 150. So this distance is your y1, which is 75, plus the second weld. Again, the length of second weld is equal to the length of first weld, which is 150 multiplied by y2. y2 is this distance. y2 again is the distance of the center of gravity of the second weld from the origin on y axis. So it is again 75. And your third weld, the length of the third weld is 100 multiplied by y3. y3 is this distance. It is the distance of the center of gravity of the third weld, that is g3, from the origin on y axis. This is your y3. So the length of y3 is 150 divided by the total length of all the welds, that is 150 plus 150, 1 plus 100, that is 400. So this will give you your y bar or yc, which will be equal to, so this will be equal to 93.75 mm from the bottom. Now this is from the bottom because we have kept our Cartesian coordinate system at this point. So actually this 93.75 is this distance from here to here, which makes this y bar, or the distance of the center of gravity from the top, as 150 minus 93.75, which will be equal to 56.25 mm. So now you have the coordinates for the center of gravity, which are 93.75 mm comma 50 mm. I have written over here 93.75 because I have not kept my Cartesian coordinate system at the top. I have kept it at the bottom. That's why I have to measure the distance from this point or from the x-axis. Now the next thing in this which we have to do is to find out the area of all the welds. Now the area of the first weld is equal to 150 multiplied by the throat length. Similarly, the area of the second weld is equal to again 150 multiplied by throat. We have written 150 over here and here because the length of the first and the second weld is 150. And the area of the third weld is 100 because the length is 100 multiplied by T, which makes the total area equal to area of the first weld plus area of the second weld plus area of the third weld. This will be equal to 150 plus 150 plus 100 multiplied by T, which will make it as 400T mm square. So the total area is 400T mm square. Now, since we have the area and we already know what is the load acting on this weld is 25 kilo Newton. So the primary shear stress can be calculated from these two values, that is the load upon the total area of the weld. Now the load is 25,000 newtons and the area is 400 multiplied by T, where T is the throat length. So this will be equal to 62.5 upon T Newton per mm square. So your primary shear stress is equal to 62.5 upon T Newton per mm square. Always remember to write the units which you are going to use. The next thing which we have to find out in order to get the total or the resultant shear stress is your secondary shear stress. Now the secondary shear stress is equal to M into R divided by J, where J is the polar moment of inertia and M is the moment of inertia. Now moment of inertia is equal to P cross E. P again is 25,000 and E, as we calculated it, is 150 mm. So the moment will come out to be 37,50,000. This will come out to be 37,50,000. And the units obviously will be Newton mm. This is Newton. Now the next thing is to find out what is R. Now this is very important. First of all, we need to know what exactly is the distance R, and we have to show it in our figure. What do we exactly mean by R? So this is your center of gravity, and this point, which is denoted by A over here, or this point, are the two points where maximum shear stress will be induced, or maximum secondary shear stress will be induced, because the secondary shear stress is directly proportional to the distance R, and these are the two farthest distance. So this distance from G to A will give you your R. This is your R. Now this distance, as you can see from the figure, is 50. This distance you have calculated to be equal to as 93.75 mm. Now very easily you can find out what is R using Pythagoras theorem. So your R will come out to be, if you are going to use the Pythagoras theorem, it will come out to be 106.25 mm. Okay. Now the next thing is, or the last, rather the last thing is to find out the polar moment of inertia. Now the polar moment of inertia about the center of gravity is equal to the polar moment of inertia of the first weld about center of gravity plus the polar moment of inertia of the second weld about center of gravity plus the polar moment of inertia of the third weld about center of gravity. Now, if you see, the length of the first weld is equal to the length of the second weld, and they both are equidistant from the center of gravity. Equidistant from G. That's why the polar moment of inertia of the first weld about center of gravity will be equal to the polar moment of inertia of the second weld about center of gravity. So we can say that the total polar moment of inertia of all the welds about center of gravity will be equal to twice multiplied by the polar moment of inertia of the first weld about center of gravity plus the polar moment of inertia of the third weld about center of gravity. So we have to first of all find this and then this. So let's see what is polar moment of inertia of the first weld about G. So this will be equal to the polar moment of inertia of the first weld about its own center of gravity plus, using the parallel axis theorem, I'm going to write this equation, plus A of the first weld, or the area of the first weld, multiplied by R1 square. Now, what is R1? Let's see in the figure. What is R1? R1 is the distance of the center of gravity of the first weld from the center of gravity of the structure of or all the welds. This is your R1. Let me change the color. This distance is your R1. It is the distance between G and G1. Where G1 is the center of gravity of the first weld. This is R1. Similarly, this distance is R3. This distance is R3. R3 is the distance between G and G3. And this distance is your R2, which is the distance between G and G2. And as we have already established the relation between R1 and R2, which is that your R1 is equal to R2, because this weld is symmetric about the vertical axis, that's why these two distances are equal. And obviously the lengths of the first and the second weld are equal. So let's see how we are going to find out R1. So this distance is 50, as you can see over here, and this total distance is 150. Obviously this distance from here until G1 will be 75, because the center of gravity of the first weld will obviously lie at the geometric center. This distance from here until here, this particular distance will be equal to 75 minus R3, or 75 minus 56.25. Okay, so if you know what is this distance, you know what is this distance, so easily using the Pythagoras theorem you can find out what is R1. R3 you already know is equal to 56.25. Now you have all the three distances, R1, R2 and R3. You know what is A1. A1 is your T into L, which is 150 into L for the first weld. R1 you have already calculated from there, it will be 75 minus R3. Now we are interested in finding out what is JG1, or the polar moment of inertia of the first weld about its own center of gravity. This will be equal to IXX plus IYY. Now IXX in this particular case will be equal to TL cube, obviously L1 cube, upon 12, plus IYY will be equal to L1 T cube upon 12. Now in this particular situation, you are going to neglect IYY, or the term with the T cube. That is because T is very small and its cube will even be smaller. That's why for the ease of calculation, we can neglect this. So your JG1 will be equal to T L1 cube upon 12, or T multiplied by 150 cube upon 12. So that's how you are going to find out what is JG1. You know what is A1, it is 150 into t, you know what is r1. So you can easily find what is j1 g. Next we have to find out what is j3 g. Now your j3 g is equal to j g3, which is the polar moment of inertia of the weld 3 about its own center of gravity, plus a3 multiplied by r3 square. From that figure you already know what is r3, you know what is r3, you know what is a3. A3 is equal to I believe the length of the third weld is 100 multiplied by t. Now you only need to find out what is j3g. Again j3g will be equal to ixx plus iyy. Now ixx for j3 is equal to l t cube upon 12 plus iyy will be equal to t l cube upon 12. In this case you are going to neglect ixx because ixx is the term which is having t cube, and as I told you, t itself is very small and its cube will be even smaller. So again, for the ease of calculation, you can neglect this. It will not have any major effect on your result. So now you know what is jg3, you know what is a3, you know what is r3, so you can easily find out what is j3g. So finally you will be able to get what is j, or the polar moment of inertia about the center of gravity of all the welds. That will be equal to j1g multiplied by 2 plus j3g. These value you can find out from these equations. Now the exact value for the polar moment of inertia about center of gravity is It is 1817708T, where T is the throat length, mm to the power 4. Now you can find out what is secondary shear stress because you know what is M, you know what is R, and you now know what is J. So your secondary, if you put the exact values of all these three things, you will get your secondary shear stress, which will be equal to 219.2 upon t newton per mm square. Now you have tau 1 and tau 2. The only thing you don't know is the angle between tau 1 and tau 2. Once you know the angle between tau 1 and tau 2, you will be able to find out what is the resultant shear stress. So let's get back to that figure over here. Now you can see what is the direction of tau 1, what is the direction of tau 2. The direction of tau 1 obviously will be in the upward direction at this point. This will be your tau 1. This angle over here will be your theta, which will be equal to, I have written phi over here. This angle will be theta, which will be the angle between tau 1 and tau 2. So I believe you can find out what will be the value of theta very easily by using the geometry. This is basic mathematics. And once you have theta, which is 61.93 degrees, you can find out what is the resultant shear stress. So your resultant shear stress is equal to under root tau 1 square plus tau 2 square plus 2 tau 1 tau 2 cos theta. Now you have already calculated what is the value of tau 1, what is the value of tau 2, obviously in terms of t, again tau 1 and tau 2, and you can calculate the value of cos theta from that figure, and it will come out to be 61.93 degrees. And the maximum allowable shear stress, which is given to you in the question for which you have to design, is 55 megapascal. Is 55 megapascal. So if you put, if you equate the right hand side of this equation with 55 megapascal, you will get the value of T, or the throat dimension, and it will come out to be 4.63 m. It will come out to be 4.63 m, and that's how you are going to solve this problem. I hope by now it's clear to you how to design the eccentrically loaded welded joint, and you will be able to do all the question based on this concept. Thank you for listening this lecture carefully. In case you have any doubt, do comment in the comment section below and let me know. I'll try to solve your problems and clear your doubts. Thank you.